talking points to introduce her students. And Ryan Brown is one of them today, so I'm introducing him currently. He began his work with Professor Kaminsky during the summer of 2017, and he was awarded a Summer McClellan Scholarship for this work. This project was to support Professor Kaminsky's LIGO education efforts, and LIGO actually is the team, or the project that did the discovery of the gravitational waves. And in fact, last October, a Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded to the founding team members for that work. So I'm pleased to hand the floor over to Ryan so he can share with you the efforts he made to help educate folks about the foundational physics of gravitational waves, that is general relativity.
So as Dr. Pedicola said, my project is primarily talking about the six original tests for general relativity before LIGO actually detected them. So let's start with general relativity. So this is Einstein's big theory that changed a lot of our understanding of physics. The main part is space-time is basically the same thing. So it's two sides of the same coin, where first we thought it was just space that was affecting things, or time that was affecting things. He unified the two. Second part is that mass, and the more mass you have, will warp space-time, just like in this figure here. So as you can see, the more mass you have, the more it warps space-time, and they actually two objects will affect each other's plane. Now, it's important to mention that this is a two-dimensional representation of this. In reality, it's four-dimensional, and you can imagine it. And another thing is that it talks about geodesics, which is basically that light always takes the shortest path, straight line, to wherever it's going. So that means on a curved surface, it will sometimes curve or deflect around objects of mass. All right, so this leads me to gravitational waves. So this was something that came out of general relativity and the mathematics of it. And effectively, the gravitational waves are caused by something called a time-varying quadrupole moment, which is fancy physics talk for a rotating system that is asymmetric. So if you have two objects that are rotating around each other of different masses, or if you have a lopsided object that's rotating really fast, then that will create a quadrupole moment. And when that happens, some of the energy of the rotation and of the mass will actually convert into gravitational waves and release out into the fabric of space-time, as you can see here. Again, two-dimensional representation, not really very good. So what gravitational waves do is they travel at the speed of light in spherical directions, and they stretch space-time along one axis while stretch space-time along one axis while compressing it along another. And that travels. All right, so LIGO, or the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory, it's quite a mouthful, but it focuses on interferometry to make these extremely precise measurements. It is the most precise measuring tool in existence ever made. It works by using the property of light called interference. And this is a basic representation of what LIGO does. So you have a laser that fires through a beam splitter. Half the light goes down 2 4-kilometer long vacuum chambers, which are extremely precisely the same length. And then upon returning, they go through the beam splitter again. And because these are at 90 degree angles, and because of the properties of light, they will destructively interfere. So if everything is precise and nothing is moving, you will see no light coming out on this other side. However, and now imagine that you have a gravitational wave going by, the space-time in this direction will stretch, this side will compress, and it does that a few times, and then you'll get this what looks like a flash here. And that's the interference pattern changing in the light. Now, that can be modeled by general relativity for the gravitational wave. And here in the thin yellow line and the thin blue line, if you can see them, those are the model predictions from general relativity. And these are the two actual data points that were measured by LIGO in 2015. So what this graph is telling you about is that this axis is strain, which is like a measure of displacement of the sides. And notice that this is a 10 to the minus 21 meters. So to put that into perspective, that's 1/10,000th the width of a proton, or the difference in the width of my hair from here to the nearest star system. So very precise. And this happens in about 0.2 seconds. All right. So my project was, I wrote 6 classic tests for general relativity. These were the better ones that I could find, that showed the more compelling ones that I could find. And so that included writing course material, that included writing questions, doing derivations for the mathematics, and then eventually putting them into LaTeX and throwing them onto the LIGO website. Now, there was another component of this where, unfortunately, last semester, the original courses that were already on LIGO got corrupted and had to be remade. So I built these back up. I guess you can't really see them. Posted them back, and they are currently on the LIGO website for view. Here is, again, last semester, or this semester, during spring break, we were lucky enough to have the LIGO team here. So this is a picture of me with my advisor Kaminsky, my good friend Zach, who's right here, who helped me with the project, and Kip Thorne, who wrote the book on gravitational waves and gravitation, and was one of the Nobel Prize receivers in 2017. So that was a wonderful opportunity. So these are the 6 tests that I wrote about. Unfortunately, I only have time to talk about 3 of them today, so we're going to go ahead and skip the loop boost experiment, the Eddington experiment, and the frame dragon effect. So let's start with the anomalous orbit of Mercury, also known as the precession of the perihelion of Mercury. Now, a perihelion is in elliptical orbits. That's always the point that's closest to the Sun in the orbit. So the precession of that perihelion means that it's shifting periodically every time it goes around. Now that happens at a consistent rate, and Newtonian mechanics actually did predict this, but it predicted half the amount of shift that was observed. And so this is a problem. In physics, you predict something and then you don't match your prediction with observations, then you need to rework your equations. So general relativity comes along and adds a second component to this equation. And the second component was time, because space-time. And they ended up, general relativity ended up predicting it 43 arc seconds per century, which is exactly what was observed. Next, this is the Shapiro delay. This one I thought was really clever and very repeatable. So as you can kind of see in this graph, or this figure, mass displaces space-time in such a way where since light always travels at the same speed, regardless of the medium, if the space is stretched in between point A and point B, then it'll have to travel a slightly longer distance, so it'll take a little more time to get there. So that was the premise for testing this one. And so what they did is they fired radio waves and bounced them off of Venus, and then these would then return. And they did this before the Sun, when the Sun was not in between, and then when the Sun was in between the two objects. And they found that when the Sun was in between the path, it took 200 nanoseconds longer for the light to get back to the receivers. Now this was a very repeatable experiment, because you just needed to bounce some radio waves off of Venus, and it was again repeated by the Viking landers and the orbiters on Mars and the Cassini orbit. And those were more precise. And then binary pulsars. Now this is my favorite one. I find this very interesting. So in 1974, so not all that long ago, a couple astronomers, Hulse and Taylor, were looking at a pulsar. And for those of you who don't know, a pulsar is a neutron star that is spinning rapidly off axis. And so it lets off like these cones of light, of X-rays, that happen at regular intervals. Now, the one they were looking at had a problem. It didn't have that regular interval, so they were taking a closer look at it. So they ended up finding out that it was a binary system. So it was a pulsar and a neutron star that were rotating around each other really fast. Now, as I spoke about earlier about gravitational waves, it requires a time-varying quadrupole moment. which this created. So the interesting thing is while they were observing this, they found that the orbit of the orbital period of the two stars was decaying. And in original physics, there should be no decay because of the conservation of energy. So if no energy is leaving the system, then how can these stars' orbit be decaying? So general relativity, again, predicted that a certain amount of energy would go into gravitational waves depending on the mass and the rotation of the quadrupole moment. So that is the blue line here. That was the prediction for what the decay would be, and the red dots are the data points that they took over the course of 35 years. Now I find it funny that it was only like a 40-second change over 30 years, because it's very small, but it's pretty cool. So with that, I'd like to thank McClellan's again, because they provided funding for me to be able to do this at all over the summer, and then continue my work with Dr. Kaminsky, who was completely amazing. My friend Zach Tweedy also helped a lot with some of the hairier parts of the math and was a good source to bounce ideas off of.